I felt like my body was leaving me, like I was dying. I looked at the doctor and I told him, with the last energy in me, I said, if you tell me to push one more time, I'm just going to die on this table. And that's exactly how I felt. My birthing experience is, I would say, a very eventful one. I remember the day I found out I was pregnant. It was in September of 2011, and this was just 4 months after I got married. And it was with mixed feelings because I wasn't exactly sure I was ready for a baby. I was, at the time, dealing with, you know, trying to settle into marriage, getting to know my husband. I'd just gotten a new job a couple of months before that. I'd also just moved back to Nigeria after a few years of being away. So it was a lot for me to take in, but of course, as a newlywed, I embraced the news with excitement, you know, shared it with my husband first, obviously, and then we told our parents. And I remember that for the first couple of weeks into the pregnancy, I was eating a lot. I was eating anything and everything I could lay my hands on. And I mentioned it to my mom, and she said, oh, that's a good sign, because for some people, it's usually the other way around. So, you know, I just kept enjoying it. And then 2 weeks, I don't think that lasted more than 2 weeks. The real pregnancy experience started, and it was, I had no idea what was, you know, coming ahead of me. It was a long, 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 long journey. Nine months ended up feeling like 2 years. It was long. I woke up one morning after the first 2 weeks of excitement and eating everything, and I started to throw up. And of course, I had read and heard about morning sickness. So it was strange, but it was expected. So I didn't think about it too seriously. But then the first episode, and then the second episode, all in one day, third episode. And I remember that on the very first day this thing started, I ended up throwing up about 20 times. And I had not had any food that day. I'd not even drank water. I couldn't, because every time I tried to put something in my mouth, I threw it up. And so I was extremely weak. I couldn't go to work. So my husband took me to the hospital. And, you know, doctors first, they were like, oh, this is your first pregnancy. Don't worry, it's normal. You get used to it, you know. And they just gave me something to suppress the vomiting and sent me back home. So I went home and had to rest for a couple of days, but then this thing didn't stop. It was like that every day. Like, I would throw up. On good days, I would probably throw up about 10 times on a good day. I couldn't have anything, nothing at all. I couldn't drink water. I couldn't eat anything. I started to try different things. My mom told me to try crackers at some point. You know, I would put some crackers in my mouth and then throw it out. And then she'd say, oh, dry bread. You know, I just kept trying one thing after another, and eventually I found something that kind of worked, but it wasn't that it stayed, but at least it kept me, you know, going from like minute to minute. I would ice bottles of Coke in the freezer, and then I would chew on the ice, and that was the only thing that could sustain me. But even that, after about an hour tops, like that's the maximum I could go without having to throw up. I would run to the bathroom and throw up again. And, you know, it was just a lot dealing with this, with work. It was so much, especially because I had just started a new job and I couldn't start taking days off, you know, every day. And it got to the point where I would practically be hospitalized every other week, I think. So I would go to the hospital. So after the first episode, the second time I had to go into the hospital, the doctors told me I had something called hyperemesis gravidanum, which is an extreme form of morning sickness. And it happens in, you know, a few women, not very many, but it does happen. And so, and they told me they didn't know when, if it would stop or when it would stop. It could be for the first 3 months only for some women, and it could last the whole pregnancy or stop at any time. So I really didn't know what to expect, but it was really bad. Every single day, I would throw up so much. My boss had to, she was a woman as well, so she kind of understood. You know, I had to take days off at regular intervals. And even on the days that I went to work, I couldn't function. I had a small little room just very close to my office where there was a couch, and I would just go and lie down on the couch all day until 6 o'clock. And 6 o'clock, I would go home, get in traffic and go home. I had a discussion with my boss about my pregnancy, and I made her understand that I would not be able to function optimally at work, and she was understanding. So I would go to that little office every day and just lie down on the couch until it was time to go home, just because I had to be at work. And so this went on, like, you know, like practically every day. On top of this, I was also suffering from motion sickness, which made it worse. So the car moving from point A to point B, I would throw up every step of the way. Like, I had bags in the car that I would just use all the way. I had to get a driver because obviously I couldn't be on my own. I couldn't drive on my own. I started to lose weight, a whole lot of weight, because I wasn't taking anything. And I remember thinking several times how, if this baby was even going to survive, because I mean, I wasn't eating. I was practically not eating anything. And I would just spend a few days at home, maybe a week or two, and then I'll have to go back to hospital. They'll put me on IV fluids for a few days, 3, 4, 5 days sometimes, just to get me back. And then I'll go back home. And, you know, that just went on. We spent so much on hospital bills because at the time we didn't even have medical insurance. And so we would go to hospital 3, 4, 5 days and live with a bill of, at the minimum, maybe 100,000 if, you know, nothing serious happened during those 5 days. And this was going on every other week at the least, or what, maybe once a month sometimes on, you know, good months. I lost so much weight that my clothes couldn't fit. Like, I would wear a pair of trousers and it would drop off my body. It was that bad. I couldn't talk because I always had saliva in my mouth. I couldn't eat, I couldn't drink. In fact, I remember my husband making a joke one day saying, oh, that he has found my code or something like that, and that he will get me pregnant every year so I won't be able to talk. Because I was like, oh, I can't believe my wife can be this quiet. Because everyone around me would be talking and I'll just be looking. Like, I couldn't say anything. Because every time I opened my mouth, I couldn't even open my mouth anyway because I always had saliva in my mouth and I had to run to the bathroom to throw it out first. And I was always too tired to do that. So I ended up just sitting down for the most part and just watching everyone around me. And so this went on throughout my pregnancy. Like, it was really bad. We made several midnight trips to the hospital. For the most part, most of the time we went to the hospital was always in the middle of the night because it would get to the point where I won't be able to do anything. I would just sit on the bathroom floor and my husband would just say, okay, yeah, let's go, you know. And this happened like every time. I remember that on one of those numerous trips to the hospital, I think I was about 4 months pregnant at the time, I was so tired, like so tired. I told the doctor to just, let's end this. I remember just telling him, I can't do this anymore. Can you just terminate the pregnancy? And the doctor looked at me and he said, did you hear yourself? Do you realize what you just said? I said, yes, I know what I said. I'm tired and I can't do this anymore. Can you just terminate this pregnancy and we'll try again some other time? And he smiled. He went out of the consulting room, came back, sat down with me, and had a long talk with me. And, you know, basically just took me out of that zone I was in, because honestly, at that time, I was just done. I was just done. I just wanted my life back. And that's what I kept saying to everybody around me. I was like, I just want my life back. I just want my life back. Because I felt like somebody else. I didn't even recognize myself. I looked terrible. I couldn't talk. I couldn't go out. I couldn't do anything. I practically lost my life, more like, you know. So I kept telling everyone that I just want my life back. And that's the same thing I told the doctor. And he just talked me out of it and told me not to worry. It's just a few months. It seems very long. But he said, oh, 4 months, that means you're almost halfway gone. Don't worry. You know, before you know it will be over. And who tells you that this thing is even going to last the whole 9 months? What if it stops tomorrow? You know, just bear it. You don't know how long it's going to last. So, you know, like when you're pregnant, in the first trimester, you go every month. I can't even remember anymore. Every month for the antenatal care. And then towards the end of the pregnancy, it was every 2 weeks. And then I think the last trimester would be every week or thereabout. So I remember when I went in at 35 weeks and I was being examined, the doctor told me that the baby wasn't growing as normal and that they would have to induce me at 37 weeks or so or thereabouts. So he said he'll watch at 37 weeks. If there was still a chance that he could leave the baby for another week, they would. But if not, I should be prepared to be induced at 37 weeks. And he explained that the reason for this was because I have a scar on my tummy, which has been there since when I was a child. I had a condition called intussusception, which I had to have surgery for. And the scar is like literally the whole of my tummy. They cut me from one end to another. So which means my tummy was kind of divided, is actually till now, divided into two. And so rather than, you know, carrying a baby, the baby needed room to just grow. And I think towards the end of the pregnancy, the baby needs, you know, like all the room they can get. And rather than having that space up here, you know, normally the pregnancy would get up even, you know, below the bust line. But in my case, the pregnancy couldn't really get there because of that scar. And so the baby was crushing down on my organs, my bladder, my bowels, and, you know, he made it very pretty scary, you know, and said the best thing is to take this baby out as, you know, as soon as the baby is okay to come out. So I started to prepare for that. It was bittersweet for me. I was very scared. I was worried about, you know, them bringing out the baby too early. But I was also thankful that I was getting to the end of this journey. So the day on the 37th week appointment, when I went, he checked and he said, oh, this baby can still stay another week. We'll do it at 38 weeks. So I went back home and they told me to come in on a Friday night and they were going to start the process on a Saturday morning. So I checked into the hospital on Friday night. In all of this, I still couldn't eat. It was the same. The hyperemesis went on for the whole time, like throughout the whole pregnancy. So I got to the hospital. As usual, they put me on IV fluids. Because I wasn't eating or drinking anything, I would always tap on my belly when I didn't feel any movement, you know, or hear anything. I would tap my belly just to be sure that, you know, this baby is still there, this baby is still alive, you know. And it was just, it was like that until the end. I was really scared because every day I kept thinking, okay, I've come this far, this baby has to make it. Like, I can't go through all this and not have a baby to show at the end of it. On the Friday night when I got to the hospital, they kind of talked me through the induction process, and they said they were going to start by inserting something like a ball into my vagina, and it was going to be there all night or so. I don't remember the details, but I remember them putting in something. And then they said the rest of the process or the procedure was going to continue in the morning. So I did that. Obviously, I didn't get much sleep. I was very anxious. Saturday morning came, it was 7 o'clock. The doctor came in and he talked to both of us, myself and the other woman who was in the ward with me. And he said they were going to start, like, do the same thing for both of us almost at the same time. And they were going to start by breaking the water. And he said he was going to start with the woman, since she had gone through it before. And I think her previous birthing experiences were also, you know, same process. I think she was induced. So it wasn't supposed to be strange, and she was supposed to just flow with it and encourage me. And so the doctor went to her first and talked her through, you know, what he wanted to do. And this woman started screaming. She was screaming so much. She was crying, shouting, telling the doctor not to touch her. I can't do this. Don't touch me. Don't touch. She was screaming seriously. And I lay down on my bed and I'm thinking, this person is supposed to be encouraging me. And, you know, it was the exact opposite. She was scaring me so much that at some point I had to just call the doctor and I said, you know what, if she's not ready, just start with me. Like, I've never done this before, but I might as well just get this thing over with. Just start. Let's just do what we need to do and get it over with. And so the doctor showed me what he was going to use. It was a pair of scissors. The mouth wasn't as sharp as the regular scissors that we use to cut stuff, but it was a pair of medical scissors. I don't know what it's called, but it was a pair of scissors. And he told me he was going to insert it into my vagina and push hard. I asked him if it was going to be painful. He said, just a little. You feel more of pressure than pain. Just relax. I said, okay. And I relaxed and I felt the most excruciating pain of my life. I screamed so much. Like, I don't know if the whole hospital could hear me, but I screamed. It was so painful. It was so damn painful. Like, it felt like the thing was going to come out of my mouth or something. It was so painful. And, you know, it took about, I don't know, it didn't take long. It was a few minutes, but those few minutes felt like forever. Maybe 2-3 minutes. And it was like, oh, done. I'm done. That's it. And, you know, they had put a nurse with me. My husband was there as well. And there was a bed cover, you know, like a rubber bed cover or something. And after he did that, I saw all the water. They call it water, but it's not actually water because it was colored, slightly brownish, and everything just gushed out of my body. And I think the next thing after that was they gave me an injection. I think it's called oxytocin or something like that. And they said it was going to help, you know, the contractions come on very quickly. And I remember that when I was going into the hospital, because I had read so much, you know, I had a notepad with me that I was going to use to time my contractions. I even went with my laptop. I was watching a movie. I can't remember what movie I was watching, but I started to watch a movie because when the contractions started, I thought, is this what they call contractions? It's not even painful. It felt more like menstrual cramps, you know, something I had gone through for years and years. So it really didn't, I didn't think it was going to be worse than that. But right after that injection, the pain, like, I can't even explain it. The pain was so bad. I don't even know where I threw the notepad, because initially when the thing started, I was timing it, I was writing. The doctor came in, he saw me writing. He was like, ah, this woman, you're still writing. He laughed at me, he said, don't worry. I didn't understand what he meant, but he said, don't worry, you'll be fine. You know, and he left. When the pain started, I was holding the railings of the bed. If not because hospital beds are metal, I'm pretty sure I would have broken the bed that day, because I held onto it so much and I was slamming it against the wall. The pain was so much. It was so much. Like, I don't know. I don't know how to explain it. That's like the worst pain ever. I don't think anything can be physically more painful than that. It was so bad. The nurse was on one, she sat like at the head of the bed with me, and then my husband was just beside her. And so I was telling both of them to rub, because the pain, I couldn't even tell where the pain was coming from. It felt like it was both in front and behind. It was, you know, at the pelvic area, and then it would travel all the way to my back. And so while I was still trying to deal with the pain in front, the back pain would start, and then I'll tell my husband to rub my tummy, and then I'll shout at the lady to rub my back, and then while she's doing it, I'll shout at my husband. Like, it was so crazy. So while that was going on, my neighbor was also going through hers. I guess after the doctor had broken my water, she finally agreed for them to start hers as well, and he did, and she also took the injection or something, and you know, so both of us were in pain at the same time. I was screaming, she was screaming, you know, and it was just crazy. So the doctor would come check and say, oh, you're progressing, you know, we're almost there, you're progressing. And then he came first time, he said, oh, I think he said I can't remember if it was 3 or 4 centimeters dilated. And then he would go after another like half an hour, come back. And then he said I was 5 centimeters dilated. He went and came back, said I was 6 centimeters dilated. And all of this, I remember, because the whole process started at around 7 o'clock in the morning. All of this went on till about noon. Remember that around 12, half past 12 or thereabout, I was 7 centimeters dilated. And around 1 o'clock or thereabout, I saw that they wheeled the other woman out of the ward and into the to the labor room. And in about half an hour, she had a baby. Because one of the nurses came in and said, oh, she had a baby. And I was like, wow. So fast, you know, so I was really excited. I thought mine was also going to be that way. So I was just waiting for the doctor to come back and tell me, okay, you are now 10 centimeters dilated. Let's go into the labor room. And he kept coming back around 2:30 when the doctor came to check on me. And he said I didn't seem to be progressing. And, you know, he didn't really tell me much. He just said, oh, you don't seem to have progressed past the 7 centimeters. But I was in too much pain to even ask questions, you know. But my mom was also with me, and I know my mom and my husband kept talking to the doctors. I really wasn't interested in what they had to say. I just wanted this baby out. Like, that was the only thing on my mind. So I knew that if there was any information, they would have passed it on to me. But I was just hoping that I would, you know, just progress past this stage. I remember also reading about, you know, pain relief options like epidural and all those things. And it was at that time I started to wonder, why wasn't I even offered any of these options? Because the pain was so bad. And I remember asking the doctor at that time, can I get something for this pain? I can't bear this pain, it's too much. And he said, oh, you've gone way past that stage. We can't use anything for you anymore. You have to go through the pain. So around, they kept coming to check, and they weren't saying much anymore, but from their, you know, the countenance of the doctors, the way they were, you know, whispering and all that, I knew that I wasn't progressing that much. So I think around 4, 4:30, thereabouts, almost 5 o'clock in the evening, this was after, you know, having these contractions for hours, the medical director came in to the ward, and you know, he also came to examine me, and he said, you know what, let's try. At that point in time, I don't know how far gone I was. I don't know if I had progressed past the 7, but I knew I wasn't where they wanted me to be. So he said we should go into the labor room and just try and bring this baby out. I was weak, I was tired, because I mean, all of this, I hadn't eaten for months, for like a year actually. I hadn't had anything to eat or drink, and I had spent the last energy in me screaming my lungs out. So I just thought, okay, you know what? Let's just get this over with. So we got to the labor room, and they put me on the table, and they told me to hang my legs. The place looked like a, I don't know, for lack of better word, slaughterhouse. It was just a flat table. I thought it was, I mean, I was expecting more than that, you know. I don't know what I was expecting really, but when I got in there and I saw the place, I was like, so this is where I'm going to have my baby, like, just like this. So they put me on the table and told me to hang my legs. There were two poles, and the two poles had like ropes on them. So they stuck each of my feet into, you know, into those two ropes. And they told me to push. After they had settled me, are you relaxed? Are you, yes, asked all the questions. There were two doctors, I think two nurses as well. And I don't know, there were just people there. My husband was holding my hand and they told me to push. And I honestly didn't even know what I was supposed to do, because they were just shouting push. And then one of the nurses was telling me, oh, you need to push, you need to push, so that we can just bring this baby out. You need to push, you know. And I don't know what I thought I was doing, but I think I did something like push. They told me what to do. They told me to squeeze my body, and I tried to do what they asked me to do, but I just couldn't. And then when they said it the second time, I looked at the doctor and I told him, with the last energy in me, I said, if you tell me to push one more time, I'm just going to die on this table. And that's exactly how I felt. I just felt at that time that I was just going to die, because I didn't have any energy left in me. And I was wondering, like, how am I supposed to push this baby out? With what? You know, already they were talking about assisted delivery, forceps or something. Maybe I just knew that I couldn't do any of those things they were talking about. So immediately I said that, you know, he looked at me, he examined me for a few minutes and said, let's prepare her for surgery. And this was around 5 o'clock. Within a, you know, very short few minutes, they wheeled me to the theater, the anesthetist was there, they gave me I don't know what that thing is called, but that thing that blocks, not, it wasn't epidural, they told me the name was the other one, but basically knocked off, you know, my feeling from waist down. And, you know, there was an anesthetist just right beside me. There were two doctors doing the surgery, and I think two scrub nurses or so, I don't know. My husband and my mom weren't allowed into the theater, but I could see them. There was a window just, you know, at the theater, and I could see them from where I was lying down. And I remember the doctor told me, you know, just keep looking at your husband. And within 30 minutes of, you know, the whole process, after when they put in the pain blocker, I had to wait a few minutes for things to take effect, because they kept asking, you know, they would tap me somewhere and say, can you feel anything? So I guess at the point where they were sure that the thing had traveled to all the places it was supposed to be, they started the surgery. And within 30 minutes or so, I felt pulling and tugging, you know, and I just felt some kind of instant relief, pull the baby out. And I don't know how I felt, but it was just, I felt free, I felt liberated. But even in all of this, I remember that right after that thing kicked in, I kind of slipped away, in a way, you know. I was talking. I remember the doctor told the anesthetist to keep engaging me in conversation and not allow me to sleep. I don't know why that was, but I know she kept talking to me, she was asking me questions, and I was answering her. But I wasn't very conscious. I knew what was going on in my environment. I knew I was on an operating table. It seemed like I was there, but I was far away. And I could practically see myself going. Like, I don't know, I wish I could explain it better, but I felt like my body was leaving me, like I was dying. I could see myself in like an endless journey, you know, this space, just some empty space. No sound, no color. It was just there. I was just there, just going. And I remember asking the anesthetist if I could see my dad. My dad wasn't around at the time. I knew that if he was around, he would have been at the hospital with me, but I felt like I was going to die at that particular time. And, you know, I looked out the window. My husband was there, my mom was there, and I thought, okay, the only person left for me to see right now is my dad. If I can see my dad, you know, I can just go wherever. I guess at the point when the effect of the things started to wear off, I was gradually coming back. I remember the moment they pulled the baby out, the doctor showed her to me. You know, she was so beautiful. She looked almost white. She was yellow, almost white. You know, she had so much hair. She was so beautiful. And I looked at her and I said, oh, this is the most beautiful baby I've ever seen in my life. And like, I still did not believe that that was my baby, but I just knew I was looking at the baby. And I was like, oh, she's so beautiful. She's so beautiful. And I started talking to the doctor. There were two doctors. I knew one of them. I didn't know the other one. So I started to question him because he was even closer to me than the other guy. The other guy was closing up at the time. I couldn't see what he was doing, but I could feel it. He was trying to close up. So I started asking this doctor questions, and I asked him for his name. He told me his name, and I said, oh, I like doctors. Like, I knew what I was saying, but I had no control over it. Those words just kept coming out of my mouth, and I was just looking at him. I said, oh, I really like doctors a lot. I like doctors. I like you. Doctor, I like you. Like, I honestly didn't know what I was saying, but that was the only thing that came, you know. It just kept coming. I had no control over it. And then the other doctor who performed the actual surgery, who opened me up and all, he was singing. He was singing Fuji. And I was like, oh, doctor, you're singing Fuji. He said, yes. And I said, why? Why are you singing Fuji when you're, you know, practically opening me up? And he said, yeah, because he does that whenever he's in surgery, that helps him to relax. And then we started gisting. I can't remember all the other things that I said to them, but I know I talked all through the procedure because they didn't even want me to sleep anyway. So they kept talking to me. And about maybe 40, 45 minutes after the baby was brought out, the whole thing was over. And they wheeled me out of the theater and into a ward. While they were closing up, while I was talking to the doctors, I was also looking at the baby. She was far away, but I could see, you know, they were cleaning her up and all that, and I heard her crying. And I remember when she cried, I said, oh, she's crying, you know. And they finished, wheeled me, you know, out. And I remember, you know, while I was being wheeled out, my mom was there with me while we wheeling the bed out. And I remember that I kept telling her, for those who understand Yoruba, I kept saying, ah, mommy, Olorun Tobi. Because at the time, that was the only thing, I had just experienced something that I couldn't explain. It was, I don't know what it was. It felt supernatural, it felt spiritual. It felt deeply physical at the same time. It was just, I couldn't explain it. And the only thing that I could attribute it at the time was God. And I was just telling my mom, God is great. God is great. And that's what I kept saying until they wheeled me into the ward. And when I got into the ward, they, you know, they carried me from the stretcher that I was on and put me on the bed with the stretcher for whatever reason, I don't know, because they told me I had to keep my back straight. So they put me with it and said I was going to be there for a few hours before they removed the stretcher and I could lie down normally on the bed. So I was just there, you know, just on one spot, just lying down. I think I drifted off for a few minutes. I fell asleep. My baby still wasn't with me. I didn't know what was going on. I asked my mom and she said the baby was fine. And a few minutes after the surgery, I noticed that all the doctors who performed the surgery, the two doctors and the medical director and another doctor who was also on duty in the hospital, and I think two nurses, they all came into the room. And when I saw them, I knew something was wrong.